I'm Valentin, and today I'm talking about an interesting feature of the Go compiler, which is inlining. We'll see what function inlining is, a few examples, how inlining relates to other compiler optimizations, and how to talk to the compiler in order to encourage effective inlining. Inlining is when the compiler, instead of generating the assembly instructions of a function call, decides to copy and paste the function body instructions at the call site. This tends to make the runtime execution faster, and we will see why. This also tends to make the compiled binary larger, because now the full body of the function may be compiled at several places inside the program. An actual function call executes quite a few assembly instructions that I will not even pretend to understand. But basically, it feels compelled to copy some data to the stack and to teleport to some other location inside the program to find the next instructions to be executed. This takes a little bit of time, and this is why inlining makes a program faster, by ignoring all of this overhead and focusing only on the function body. Here is a visual metaphor. When a gopher wants to ask a question about Go, of course, they go to the popular website Stack Gopher Flow. Here is a question. How can I shuffle a slice? And here are several answers from the community. So call run.shuffle, and this looks like the Fisher-Yates algorithm, okay? So in my opinion, it's a good practice to have all of the answers in line in the same page as the question. Imagine if all of the answers were just links to a solution that lives somewhere else. That would not be super fun to parse. That it would involve a lot of clicks, more HTTP requests, and some mental context switching. In this fictitious example, I definitely vote for inlining. The good news is the compiler usually takes care of inlining automatically, without any work or cognitive burden for the developer. Inlining is a rather low-level concern that's mostly the job of the compiler. My rule of thumb and my advice is relax. Don't try too hard to force inlining your function calls unless you have evidence that your project really needs it and will benefit from it. At one end of the performance spectrum on the left, many business apps don't require high performance. At the other end of the spectrum on the right, some very high performance concerns require more advanced techniques than inlining, and not all of them can actually be implemented in Go. In the don't care area here, there are also projects that would really benefit from performance optimizations, but not of inlining, rather from optimizations of very expensive operations like network requests, file system input-output, and memory allocations. There's a narrow sweet spot, though, where inlining truly benefits your program automatically, and an even more narrow sweet spot where you, as a developer, may want to explicitly do some work to enable inlining and make the magic happen. To be eligible to inlining, a function must be small and simple. If it contains too many instructions, then it's not inlined. If it contains some complex excluded features like recursion or defer, then it's not inlined. For each function, a complexity score is computed based on the number of things in the abstract syntax tree or AST. Then this score is compared to the inlining budget per function, which is 80. What does 80 mean? In practice, it's a pretty low budget, which allows only really small functions to be inlined. Let's say that my program can run in two modes. Debug, where many debug lines are printed to the standard error, and production, where the debug lines are not printed. This sample function computes the sequence of the collapse conjecture from a positive integer n to the final value 1, and returns the number of computation steps. This function doesn't have debug logs yet. If you have never heard of the collapse conjecture, it's fine. It's just an arithmetic computation of a sequence of integers. We are not interested in the computation details. Now I introduce the function debugf, which does this. If I'm debug mode, then print the argument. If I'm in production mode, then do nothing. The debug mode is a compile time constant, which I set to true during the development phase and to false before shipping to production. What I want to achieve is a zero-cost abstraction. I want the runtime cost of debugf to be exactly zero when debug has the value false. This should be possible in theory thanks to two compiler optimizations. Dead code elimination, DCE, which would remove the conditional if block here, and the inlining of the now empty debugf function body. I can write a benchmark to measure if there's a significant performance difference between the original code without any debug statements and the new production code with debug statements that are supposed to be no ops. If the performance is the same, then it's a good clue that inlining happened and correctly removed all of the debug instructions because the debug mode constant value is false. The benchmarks don't provide any formal proof about inlining, but they still provide with useful clues. Here we run the benchmark and see that the results are roughly the same, which means that the compile time optimizations successfully kicked in. My debugf functions is effectively a zero-cost abstraction. If you pass the GC flags -m equals 2 to the go build command, or to the go test command, you will get a verbose output that says exactly which function calls are inlined or not and why. This is the proper way to check which function calls are inlined. Cost 0 here means that the function body has been parsed and translated into 0 instructions because the condition is always false. The inlining has evolved and improved in newer releases of Go. To test a specific Go version, say 1.12, it's very convenient to simply go get it with these two commands. I really love this feature of the tooling. To compare with many versions of Go, well, I can download many versions of Go in a bash loop. In this card, the bars represent execution duration of my collapse with debug benchmark. Smaller bars are better. We can see a huge outlier in Go 1.8, which was not able yet to optimize out my debugf as a no-op. The compiler generated a function call. The function was indeed called at runtime at each computation step, and this dominated the total computation time. In all subsequent versions of Go, the inlining kicked in. Let's ignore Go 1.8 for now and zoom in. It is normal that a new version of Go can make your existing code a bit faster or a bit slower. Of course, we prefer when everything goes faster and faster for free, but that's not always the case. The more interesting fact here for our inlining quest is that for every release from Go 1.10 and above, the blue bar and the purple bar have the same size. This shows that in production mode, having debugf statements that resolve into no op effectively incurs no performance penalty at all. Here is the story of a little experiment I made years ago. Before inlining was effectively a thing, these were a few options for toggling debug logs off and on. You could use a variable Boolean condition inside a debug func. The advantage of this technique is that it can be turned off and on anytime during the program execution. The drawback is that it will always incur a non-negligible performance penalty, one function call plus one conditional. Using a constant value incurred basically the same performance problem. When DCE, the dead code elimination, was less sophisticated, even testing a constant would incur a runtime performance penalty. However, the more severe burden was the cost of calling the function. This is the same implementation that we've seen in the collats example, but in the prehistory, without inlining in Go 1.8 and below, this was not efficient at all. How about wrapping each debug F call inside an explicit if block? This effectively saves an expensive function call when the constant or variable condition is false. The downside is that it's more visually verbose in terms of screen real estate. 3 lines of code instead of 1 for each debug print everywhere in the program. In this merciless world, was it even possible to print some debug data with a single line of code without incurring any overhead in production? Technically, we could achieve a one-liner that tests the constant value at compile time, which will produce either the constant false for the whole expression, or a function call to debug f, which now returns a boolean. We must discard the boolean value with the blank identifier, otherwise it doesn't compile and says evaluated but not used. Seriously, you don't want all of your zero-cost one-liner debug statements to look like this. Thank you, inlining, for saving us from this monstrosity. This sort of syntax is no longer necessary. Now we can have simple and efficient debug F calls, as we've seen in the collats example. Now here is the true story of an inlining optimization with a happy ending. In the past, the compiler used to inline only leaf functions, that is, functions that don't call any other function. Then mid-stack inlining capabilities were introduced, which allow some small functions to be inlined even if they have calls to other functions like panic or thumped.print, which are pretty complex per se. This is a 2019 commit by Carlo Alberto Ferraris. It's effectively splitting a large method into two smaller methods. Methods are functions, so methods can be inlined too. Let's zoom a bit and focus on important lines. This says that the new unexported method logSlow is the slow path, and that the exported method log contains an inlinable fast path. The fast path consists of a single call to atomic.comparenceSwapIn32. If this call returns true, then log returns immediately, and the slow path doesn't need to be executed at all. The slow path consists of a large for loop containing quite a lot of code. Let's look at it from the point of view of the call site. The original log method contains 3 lines of fast things plus many lines of slow things. It is never inlined because it's way over budget. The green arrows represent the overhead of calling the function, the method, and returning from the method. We cut the method in two parts. Log calls log slow. Now we have 2 function calls instead of 1, the green arrows back and forth here. But wait, mid-stack inlining is possible since Go 1.12. The method log, which has very few instructions, is now inlined. It fits within the tight inlining budget, even if it contains a function call to the expensive method log slow. Okay, so now instead of a single call to the method log, we end up with a single call to the method log slow. Did we actually gain anything in this whole transformation? Yes. Most of the time there is no function call at all, because the fast thing returns true. That is, the compare and swap operation succeeds, and there is no need to take the slow path. This is a probabilistic optimization. We've actually saved one function call in the most frequent case where the lock ownership is smoothly and swiftly granted. In my two examples so far, I've mostly emphasized the performance gain of avoiding the overhead of a function call. But there's much more to the benefits of inlining than the cost of a function call. This is the central idea of my talk, and the reason why I find inlining so fascinating. It enables a rollback of other compiler tricks. When a function is not inlined, of course we have to pay the runtime cost of calling the function. But the compiled code may also be suboptimal in a less obvious way. As these two blocks of code, the purple one and the blue one, are compiled independently, they can't take advantage of each other's implementation specifics. All they know and agreed upon is the signature of the function. The body of compute can only take into account the signature. It knows that it's receiving three arguments of type string and needs to compute and return two values of type int. And the bar block of code here is only aware of what is written above the fold, and that R and S have the type int. On the other hand, when the function is inlined, suddenly we have much more context about all of the instructions involved. The inline body may take advantage of the details inside the foo-foo block above. For example, if one of the arguments is a constant, if a pointer argument is probably nil or probably non-nil. But wait, there's more. The bar block may take advantage of the function body in addition to the foo-foo block. For example, it may infer that R and S can only take a very limited range of possible values. This intimate knowledge was not part of the function signature. But wait, there's more. These clever inferences are not limited to the code above the current block. It is now possible for the function body to detect that one of the return values is never subsequently used and to decide to not compute it altogether. But wait, there's more. Likewise, the foo-foo block may inspect the function body, detect that in this specific context one of the arguments is not used at all inside the function, and elide the value memory location, and elide the computation from the final assembly code. My point is basically this. In the non-inline form, where the function body is decoupled from the function call site, none of these optimizations are possible. While in the inline SSA form, the compiler is able to perform a variety of optimizations. SSA stands for static single assignment. This is a technique by which the execution flow is rewritten in such a way to facilitate constant propagation, efficient register allocation, etc. Also, the inline form allows the compiler to reorder the instructions in such a way that they compute the same result, but in a more efficient way. For example, by using fewer CPU registers and reducing the need to access the central memory. It is not technically possible to tell the compiler, you must inline this function. Such a pragma does not exist. It is, however, possible to have a polite back-and-forth negotiation with the compiler and structure time-sensitive functions in such a way that they will be inlined. Always use the -m equals 2 to determine which function calls could not be inlined and why. The output is surprisingly clear and actionable. For example, this method notifyRequest is over budget with a cost of 88, which makes it a good candidate for inlining, if we manage to simplify it just a little bit. If your favorite function consists of several sequential steps, then you may be able to artificially decrease its cost by splitting it into two smaller functions. Note that This will make your code less convenient because each call site will now need to call two functions instead of one. Some common operations simply prevent inlining. It is sometimes possible to refactor the code to avoid them. Range. The range loops are excluded. However, a range loop over a slice can be trivially rewritten into a simple for loop. Defer statements can most often be moved and replicated at each exit point of the function. I'd like to say a word about decoupling, which is useful for humans, and coupling, which can make machines and processes in general more efficient. This is an important idea. The main benefit of inlining comes from coupling. In the left column is the world of sustainable software engineering, where behaviors are encapsulated into functions and methods, and the function signatures are a strong contract between the function and the call site. Your Go source code belongs to the left column. In the right column, we have a very integrated soup of assembly instructions produced by the compiler to maximize efficiency. This also implies that the effective performance of a function does not depend only on the function body itself, it also depends on the shape of the code that is calling the function. Here is again a visual metaphor that may or may not stick to your head. When cooking a meal, you may have different ingredients for the different courses. Meat for the main course, strawberries and cream would be for dessert, banana and cream would also be for dessert. You're not supposed to mix them all before serving. But if you do, you end up with something a bit disgusting, which may also happen to be more efficient for some purpose. Inline functions end up as such a soup of assembly instructions. They are not human readable anymore, but they are also more efficient. To summarize, the obvious performance benefit of inlining is to save the overhead of a function call. The extra performance benefit of merging and coupling code at compile time is to enable even more local optimizations. Bound check elimination, dead code elimination, instruction reordering, efficient register allocation, constant propagation, etc., etc. You can see in the green bar here that the execution of A and B in a tightly coupled way is surprisingly faster than the sum of the durations of A and B. This is great because in the general case, different kinds of optimizations tend to combine well when they are orthogonal. Other optimizations sometimes interfere with each other, which decreases the total benefits. But here it's the opposite. Inlining removes function call overhead and also combines with other optimizations to make them even more powerful. That's it for today. Thank you so much for watching.